Hi guys, how you doing? If you're watching this in the future, you will catch this intro. We're just waiting for a few people to turn up. My name's Nick Jennison. Thank you so much for joining me. This is the first of a series of live lessons for the Guitar Interactive Livestream Hub. You can check out links in the description to this video if you want to know how to join the Livestream Hub. That's how you're going to access these lessons in the not too distant future. So while we're waiting for people to arrive, I'm just going to play a little bit. Let's do some of this. So we got some eyes going on there. Excuse the flub at the start. I forgot to switch my distortion on the amp. So listen, hi guys, how you doing? My name's Nick Jennison, if you just joined us. This is the first of a series of lessons that we're going to be doing on the Guitar Interactive Livestream Hub. If you want to check out the Livestream Hub, there is a link in the description. It's completely free. So it's just a Facebook group that you guys are going to join, and it's going to allow you to access these lessons in the future. It's also going to allow you to ask questions, and also we're going to start bringing you guys in on these streams so you can be on camera with us. There's going to be some hangs kind of in the broadcast studio before and after we do the stream too. So lots of cool perks for joining the Livestream Hub. The topic of today's discussion, however, is pentatonics, modes, and beyond. And like I said, this is part one of a course that we're going to be doing as a live stream series of videos. So to begin with, we're going to start talking about the relationship between chords, pentatonic scales, and then full diatonic scales, which refers to essentially the church modes that you may or may not be familiar with if you've heard terms like Ionian, Dorian, Phrygian, all that kind of business. That's what we're talking about. So it's the connection between chords, pentatonic scales, and kind of modes and all this sort of business. So let's start by talking about some chords. So beginning with the chord families. There are three chord families that we're going to talk about today. Essentially, we have what I'm going to refer to as major, minor, and dominant chord families. Now, we're going to be in the key of A because we have a backing track that's going to work in A minor. You'll also get access to that backing track via a link in the description. That's a YouTube video that you can go and check out if you want to jam along. So, real quick, let's talk about our chord families. If we have a minor chord, you might think about this as either A minor or A minor 7. This is like a minor family chord, and there are a series of scales that we're going to attach to this. We also have a major family chord, which would be A major 7, and we have a dominant family chord, which would be A 7. Now, the difference between these three chord families is in the third and in the seventh. Now, for those of you who aren't familiar, chords are made up of essentially three or four notes. If they're made of three notes, we'd call it a triad. If they're made of four notes, we'd refer to it as just a chord or a seventh chord, for example. You can extend this further with what we'd call extensions, but that's not really the topic of today's lesson. So real quickly, let's explore the difference between our minor chord, our dominant chord, and our major chord. So very quickly, a minor seven chord might look something like this. And that's essentially going to involve root, minor third, fifth, and minor seven. Now, if we take the third and raise that up by a semitone, in this case, it's going to be a C note, which will raise up to a C sharp. This would give us a dominant chord, which sounds something like this. And this is the sort of thing that's very common in a 12-bar blues, for example, which is an application we're going to get onto when we start exploring dominant pentatonic type playing. Now, the last one we're going to do, if we retain that major third, that raised third, but we take the flat seven, in this case it's a G note, and we raise that up to a natural seven, which is a G sharp, we get a major seven chord, which sounds like this. Which is a very pretty sound. I'm sure you've all heard it before. So very quickly, just to rattle through those, we have minor seven, dominant seven, and lastly, major seven. So we're going to begin by taking a look at some minor chords, minor seven chord, and how that relates to our pentatonic scale. Now I have some tab that we're going to take a look at up here. So we're going to begin with a minor seven chord, which is kind of highlighted over here. If you take a look at that chord shape, we have a minor seven, and we also have an arpeggio that we can associate with that A minor chord. Now this is an A minor triad arpeggio, and it just uses A notes, C notes, and E notes, and it sounds like this. Now, the eagle-eyed among you will probably have spotted that this looks quite a lot like the first box position of our A minor pentatonic scale, which you might think of as this. And that's that good old 1-4, 1-3, 1-3, 1-3, 1-4, 1-4 that every guitar player learns, and I'm sure you're familiar with that already. So if we were to examine the difference between this A minor arpeggio and our minor pentatonic scale, I'll just throw this up here real quick. You should be able to see that. So if we, hopefully that's clear. If you're watching on a phone, this tab might be a little small, but don't worry, in the examples where it really matters, I'm gonna make it nice and big for you. You can't really see my fretboard, so what I'll do is I'll just go to this one over here real quick. You can see me very, very small. Our minor pentatonic is going to look like so. And our minor arpeggio will look like this. Now, in reality, what we've got going on here is a minor arpeggio is essentially a minor pentatonic scale, but it's missing two of the notes that are found in the minor pentatonic. In this case, it's missing the fourth degree and also missing the seventh degree, which are all the D notes and all the G notes. Now, if we just go back to our minor arpeggio real quick over here, if we were to turn that into a minor seven, like this, what you'll notice is that we've now added in all of the G notes, which gives us this. I'll just make myself a little larger and I'll play that again for you. Now this is really close to our minor pentatonic scale. We're actually only missing one note from the complete minor pentatonic scale. So real quick, if we just compare our minor seven arpeggio to, I'll just get this ready, next slide please, to an A minor pentatonic scale, what you'll notice is there's not actually a huge difference between the two. The only difference is that the minor pentatonic scale includes includes the addition of a D note, which is a fourth degree, in addition to the minor seven arpeggio. So you might think about a minor pentatonic scale essentially as being the arpeggiated notes of an A minor seven chord, but with the addition of a fourth. So it's really only like one extra note. If I just play it for you now real quick, this is the arpeggio. And the scale is going to sound like this. Do sound very, very similar to each other. Now the thing with this is what I want you to start thinking about these as, I want you to start thinking about the minor pentatonic scale as essentially as kind of an extrapolated spread out version of a minor seven chord. And this is going to become important when we start exploring playing over chord changes further down the line in this course. So think about this as kind of a primer. This is kind of where the minor pentatonic business all comes from. And it's really where it's derived from. Now this to me is kind of more of a bottom up top view where we take the chord and then we look at how that kind of like grows into a scale, rather than taking the idea of a full minor scale and then kind of like shrinking that down to a pentatonic. I feel like this is a more useful view if you look at it from chord up. Now, what we're also getting here is we're getting a degree of a hierarchy going on here, a hierarchy of importance when it comes to scale notes. Now, we know that the minor pentatonic is like the safe go-to scale when it comes to playing in the key of A minor. Of course it is. We do it all the time, right? But did you know that within that scale, there is of course this arpeggio and this triad arpeggio contained. And these triad arpeggio notes, and to a lesser extent, the seventh degree arpeggio notes, are actually probably the best sounding notes within the scale. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna throw in my backing track and I'm gonna play using just the arpeggio, just the triad arpeggio. And what I'll do is I'll actually throw the tab on screen while I'm doing this. So we're gonna begin with just this guy. Then we'll move to just this guy. And then I'll expand it out to this A minor pentatonic. And I'll throw that up on screen as we go. So real quick, bear with me. Just gonna fire off that backing track again. Got it on my phone. Here we go. Hopefully, what you should have noticed with that is that the triad notes, the triad arpeggio, sounded super safe. Every note sounded like a resolution. It sounded like you could have like stayed on any of those notes for as long as you wanted to. And that's kind of an important thing to bear in mind. When you're playing your minor pentatonic, these notes that come from the triad, and again, I'll make all this tab available to you guys after the fact in the live stream group. So make sure you join the live stream hub if you want to get access to the tab. The link is in the description. And there's also going to be a link in the chat, so make sure you click on that and you'll get access to all the tab and the back track, all that kind of business. If you're landing on these triad arpeggio notes, and we're assuming we're playing over an A minor type chord or an A minor type backing track, these are all going to be super safe, right? They're going to be really nice, comfortable, safe choices. And that's because these are all notes that are contained within the chord. Now, when we go to our A minor 7, things start to sound a little bit more colorful, a little more interesting perhaps, but then we also started to introduce kind of not quite an element of danger, because when we landed on those G notes, it still sounded good. But then when we moved to our A minor pentatonic, what you would have noticed is that when I was finishing on these D notes, they didn't sound quite as strong and quite as well resolved as the notes of the triad arpeggio. And that is, or rather the seventh arpeggio either. And that's purely because the fourth degree in the minor pentatonic is not necessarily contained within the chord tones, if you follow me, right? So basically what we're doing here is we're starting with the absolute nucleus of our chord, and then we're introducing more and more information as we expand from our triad arpeggio to our seventh arpeggio to our minor pentatonic scale. Now let's take a look at something a little bit further. This is gonna go a little past our pentatonic scale. So if we take our A minor pentatonic, and we take a little look at this guy, let me just get that ready for you. This is what I'm going to refer to as the A minor 6 note scale. And this is introducing, it's introducing one extra note into each octave. And the extra note is a B note. Now you'll see that on the 7th fret on the low E string and also on the high E string. And then on the 4th fret on our G string. Now this is getting close to a full 7 note minor scale or a full 7 note modal scale. But it sounds like this. Now, the addition of this extra note is adding just a little bit of extra color to things. The note in question is the ninth. You'll see in that header there, it says AKA minor pentatonic plus ninth. And this is a very common thing to add in rock and blues type playing. You'll hear it all the time. Players will add this ninth up here for this. I think Guthrie described it as a Thin Lizzy-esque twiddle, but it's probably best just to show you. So I'm gonna throw that backing track back on, and I'm gonna start by playing. Again, I'll keep it on the tab so you guys can see. I'll start by playing the A minor pentatonic scale, and then I'll switch across to the A minor six note scale. And you'll hear what difference adding this extra note into the pool is gonna do for us. So let's try that now. So hopefully what you can hear there is that we're getting a little bit more color and a little bit more of that kind of full kind of minor scale flavor creeping through, but we haven't gone quite as far as playing a full minor scale just yet. Now, when we get onto modal type playing, which we'll do in a future installment of this series, we'll start discussing all the different kinds of minor modes that are available, because there are in fact three minor modes that you can play. Some are more useful than others. I'll just throw that out there right now. And there's one that you're going to end up using all of the time, which I'll throw in just a little bit later on. So let's actually expand that a touch further. So here's our tab again. Keep your eyes peeled. We've got our, I'll just get rid of this. Clicked on the wrong thing there, you'll have to excuse me. There we go. If we take things from our six note minor scale, we can go right across to this guy here, which is the A natural minor, AKA the Aeolian scale, the Aeolian mode. Now, you may have heard one or both of these terms kind of in your own study, and they're basically synonyms. The natural minor is a synonym for the Aeolian mode. The Aeolian mode kind of contains all the notes of the C major scale, but it's not a C major scale. They're not the same thing. We'll get onto why in a future installment. You just have to trust me for now that they're not. Now, the difference between these two scales, if you take a look at what's contained in them, is that we've introduced one extra note. This is a seven note scale. So in every octave, we have seven notes as opposed to six notes. So this guy over here, the six note minor scale, you'll notice that contains all of these B notes, which are over here on the seventh fret on the low E string, fourth fret on the G string, and then again, seventh fret on the high E string. If we go to our Aeolian scale or our natural minor scale, we're introducing this guy over here, which is an F note. Now, the F note is going to be present on the B string on the sixth fret. It's also going to be on the A string in this position. It's going to be on the A string on the eighth fret. So it sounds a little like this. It's a really super mournful sounding scale, but it's something we've heard all the time. And this backing track that we're using today is kind of based around chords that are derived from this A natural minor scale. So this is actually gonna work really well if you wanted to jam over this backing track. It's gonna work a total treat. Let me just show you what it sounds like. And again, the approach we're gonna take with this is we're gonna start with the A minor pentatonic scale, and then I'll scroll through our six note minor scale. And then lastly, we'll get the natural minor. And we'll hear what that sounds like as we go through that. So let's fire the distortion back on. Take a listen. I hope you're jamming along, by the way. Just feel free to play over the top of me. We'll be right back. I could play that all day. I think it sounds really rather great. But what you would have noticed is, again, as we start scrolling through these and we start getting into the more dense tonal variations, which are our natural minor scale with the full seven notes, things just get more colorful, but it also perhaps gets a little less focused, shall we say. That's a topic that we're going to discuss in the future, which is a topic that I'm going to refer to as note density or tonal density. It's not the same as how fast you shred, bro. That's a different kind of note density, but it's the density of notes in your pool. Now, the other thing that you would have spotted is that this note right here, this F note that we've added, is a little less stable, shall we say, over some of the chords that are in this backing track. Now, we'll get onto why in a moment, but this essentially, when played over our A minor 7 chord, is going to be it's going to be the flat 6 or the flat 13 interval, which is a little bit clashy against the fifth. So real quick, if I was to play this, can sound a little bit kind of jarring, but there is another scale that we can use, which is another modal scale, again, expanded from our pentatonic scale, which looks a little like this. This is the natural minor scale. If we make a small alteration to this and we take all of those F notes and we move them up by a semitone to F sharps, we get this guy. This is A Dorian. And you notice there it says contains, or rather shares, the same notes as G major. It's not a G major scale. Again, I'm going to throw this out there right now. A Dorian is not the same as G major. If any of you have done that parental type learning, it is absolutely not the same thing, because it doesn't sound like the same thing and you don't play it in the same context, but it shares all the same notes. It has all the same ingredients, shall we say. Kind of, I suppose, in the same way that like a scrambled egg shares all the same notes as an omelette, but they're not the same thing. Or rather, same ingredients as an omelette, but they're not the same thing. That's a very poor analogy. But the interesting thing about this one is the F sharp note that we've added into this context rather than the F note actually doesn't sound quite as tense against our chord. Real quick, the F sharp note is here, which is going to be on the 7th fret on the B string, also here on the 4th fret on the D string. But if I just add that to our chord, it does sound more tense than just the minor 7, but it doesn't sound quite as jarring as it did before. And as a result, the Dorian, as a rule of thumb, Dorian is your go-to scale anytime you come across a minor 7 chord with no other information attached to it. So that's something that will become more important as we go forward. So we're going to cover that in a future kind of installment of this series. But the Dorian is essentially this extrapolated version, again, of this chord via an arpeggio, via a pentatonic scale, via a six-note scale, and via, again, a seven-note modal scale. Now, I actually want to just throw your attention to that one, because that six-note scale that we looked at a second ago, a six-note scale is actually found in both the Aeolian and Dorian scales. So the only difference is we've added one note to the six-note minor scale. So if you took a natural minor and removed the F notes, you get a six-note minor scale. If we took a Dorian scale and removed the F-sharp notes, you would get a six-note minor scale. And then we can extrapolate further backwards. If you remove the B notes, you get a minor pentatonic. If you remove the D notes, you get a minor 7 arpeggio. And then on top of that, if you remove the G notes, we have an A minor arpeggio, and so on and so forth. So we have this hierarchy of kind of how drilled down into the chord do we want to get. So the A minor is going to be like the most like brazen representation of our chord. A minor 7 is still just going to be playing the notes of the chord, but it's going to sound a little more sophisticated, a little more fleshed out. A minor pentatonic is a really nice balanced version of that. And then we're starting to add more color and more information as we go up this hierarchy up to our Dorian scale. Now, you can go even further with this by adding in the blanks, which would be chromatic notes. Again, very quickly, I'll just show you that. So let's do one based on this natural minor scale, for argument's sake. Chromatic notes are just all the notes that aren't in the scale. So if I took this as my scale, let's take minor pentatonic for argument's sake. And I filled in all the blanks, just played all the notes from here up to here, you get this. which I'll do for you now. So we're going to start with the A minor pentatonic, and then I'll just throw in the natural minor, and then we'll go all the way up to chromatic. Again, I'll get the tab ready so you guys can see what's going on. There's no tab for the chromatic scale, but you'll just have to trust me. You will know it when you hear it. Let's start with the minor pentatonic. Here we go. Let me just get the remote ready. Phone's decided to disconnect. Of course it is, because we're live. Here we go. Minor pentatonic first. Going pretty out there with that chromatic stuff. I'm really just trying to kind of show you the difference. But what you'll notice with that is that we've just started adding more and more information as we go on. Now let's take a look at some other chord types, because there are of course other chord types to be had. Let's take a look at the major version. So our major seventh chord, which is this guy down here, we can take the same progression with our major chord. So I'm gonna rattle through this. I'm not gonna do it in as much detail as I did with the previous one, but the same is true. So here's a major chord. And a major arpeggio, therefore, derived from that would go like this. We can take that a step further to our major pentatonic. Now you'll notice that I've missed one out here, but we'll kind of get to that. So real quick, major pentatonic would be this. I've deliberately missed out the major seven step in between these, because the major pentatonic is actually going to function just fine over an A7 chord too. So real quick, there's our A7 chord, and the major pentatonic will work just fine over that too. Really rather nicely, and in fact so does the A minor pentatonic, for reasons that we'll kind of get into in a moment. So the A minor pentatonic is an interesting one, because it works over both the dominant chord and the minor chord. Likewise, the major pentatonic will work over a dominant chord and a major chord. And of course, pentatonics are the discussion of the day. So we've already established there's a hierarchy going on here. You can kind of extrapolate this hierarchy again to major seven type things, where you would throw in like kind of a major seven type arpeggio, like so. If I just take our major arpeggio, which is this, and a major seven would be this. Now, we're not going to get into that today. I'm going to let you explore that on your own. But this is why, when you're playing in a blues context, you can blend the major and minor pentatonic pretty much at will, because they contain, well, they both contain works, notes that work over a dominant chord. So we're going to assume we're in a dominant blues, which would be this kind of thing. So on and so forth. What you can basically do with this is you can kind of blend them at will, but there is a little change that we're going to make over here to our A minor pentatonic. You'll notice over here we've taken the A minor pentatonic and we changed it into A minor pentatonic with bends. Now this is something that we do over dominant chords to optimize our major, or minor pentatonic rather, A minor pentatonic with bends. So very quickly, just take a look at the chord at the start of this this example down here, and take a look at the note that's on the G string. You'll notice over here that the note on our G string is a sixth fret note, which is a C sharp. And then if you take a look at the first note of the scale that's on the G string, it's a C natural, and this is gonna clash. So actually, I'm gonna try and play this very quickly for you, like this. So very quickly, if we take this chord right here, and then we add a C natural, I'll find a spare string. Let's try this one here, for argument's sake. That's gonna clash pretty badly. Doesn't sound very nice, but what we can do is we can bend that note. Quite difficult to do by tapping, you'll have to trust me on that one. But we can bend that to kind of optimize it to fit with our dominant sound. So very quickly, if we go back over here, let's take a look at the difference. So real quick, this is the A minor pentatonic. This is the A minor pentatonic with bends. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna play the scale against the chord. Here's the chord. People say that you can use the minor pentatonic over a dominant chord. This is actually what they're talking about, right? This is the real crux of the matter, is that you can use the A minor pentatonic scale over a dominant chord if you start to sweeten the third notes, or all the C notes in this instance. We call it the third, and that's the note that we found clashing against our chord a second ago. It's the third degree of the scale. If we bend that slightly, not quite as far as the sixth fret in this case, so it wouldn't be as far as this. It's just slightly shallow of that one. It's not quite a quarter tone, it's just slightly beyond. It's more of a feel thing. You'll kind of do this, you'll pick it up as you play. So what we're doing here is we're essentially sweetening our minor pentatonic to make it fit more neatly over an A7 chord. And if you've ever tried to blend major and minor pentatonics when you're playing blues, and you found that the minor pentatonic sounds a little dark or a little sour, this might be why. So very quickly, what I'll do is I'll just play a blended blues solo, and I'll blend the minor and major pentatonics, but I'm not gonna do any of those bends. I'm just gonna play it pretty straight. So here we go. Pretty jarring, especially when we switch to that major pentatonic. But if we start to introduce those bends, things start to sound a little bit more unified and a little bit more, more bluesy, I suppose. So that really is kind of the secret to blending these pentatonic scales if you're playing over a dominant chord type. Now, there's actually one step further we can take with this one if you so desire. I'll just show you this one as a little parting thought. This is the dominant pentatonic. Now, a dominant pentatonic is basically the same as our minor pentatonic. Just take a quick look at this. Ignore the bend signs for a moment. All we've done is all those notes that we have been bending, we just bumped them up a fret to essentially kind of occupy the same space. Now again, if you notice that note on the G string, that C sharp note on the G string on that sixth fret, that's now in our scale, and it wasn't there before. And it sounds like this. Now, you'll notice there's loads of options that we can play over a dominant chord. Now, this makes dominant chords really interesting. It makes blues soloing really interesting. And this is because dominant chords are inherently able to withstand tension. It's something that they can, you can play all sorts of crazy stuff over dominant chords. They're a lot of fun, and we'll be exploring that in the future. But essentially, this is just a quick look at how pentatonic scales derive from chord types. We focused very strongly on the minor stuff today. I wanted to take a very quick look at the major and the dominant varieties. But we're going to be looking at how you can use these pentatonic scales as kind of an axis to frame your soloing around. Whether you're playing over a single tonal center or whether you're actually playing over changes, you can do this with pentatonic scales and with extrapolated pentatonic scales, because the with full diatonic scales that are taken from pentatonics as well. The reason is because pentatonics essentially give you a really safe kind of like handful of notes that are never going to really go too wrong, and it's something you can always kind of back out into if you get a bit stuck. Again, we'll explore that more in the future. If you want to kind of catch that lesson and the lessons that address that stuff, make sure you check out the Guitar Interactive Stream Hub, a live stream hub. There is a link in the description. It's completely free. So what I'm gonna get you to do is I'm gonna get you to get in there and join the streaming hub, because it's gonna give you access to all of these lessons. The lessons that you're watching today, they're not actually gonna be available at all on the main channel. We're gonna be doing them exclusively in the streaming hub. So, but it's free, you don't need to pay anything. You don't really need to do a whole lot. But another thing we're gonna do is we're gonna start answering your questions. Then we'll only be taking questions from the live streaming hub. So I'm gonna take a little bit of a look at the comments that we have today on the lesson. Nick, there needed to be, let's see. So we've got a question here from Kevin. Hi, Kevin. Kevin says here, Kevin, is there bend needed in the major pentatonic to use it over the dominant seventh chord? Actually, no, there isn't. You don't actually need to bend anything in the major pentatonic to use it over the dominant seventh chord, because there's nothing there that's clashing. Now, the reason that you need to bend the minor pentatonic is because the third in the minor pentatonic is clashing against the third in our dominant seven chord, but there's nothing in the major pentatonic that's gonna clash against any of the notes in the dominant seven. So very quickly, what I'm gonna do, just to demonstrate this, you'll have to bear with me, I'm gonna try and play something a little strange. I wish I had something queued up that I could play this for you on, but I don't have a backing track for the dominant seven chord. It's not the end of the world though, I'll use my fingers. So how best to do this? Let me see if I can think about doing this in camera. So if I play this, and then with this hand, I tap out the notes of a major pentatonic scale. I'll just do it up the high strings. What you'll notice is that nothing is gonna clash against any of the notes of the chord, like this. But you definitely can't say the same about the minor pentatonic, because what you'll notice if I do the same thing, if I do my little tapping business again, you'll notice this note right here, which is that C note, is going to clash very, very badly against the dominant seven chord, like this. And that's even more true in lower registers. So if I do it on the A string like this, you can hear that without the bend, the minor pentatonic is rather clashy, but even in the lower register, the major pentatonic isn't that bad. Now, for the nerds in the audience, this is because the major pentatonic, in my opinion, just gonna throw it out there, this is my opinion, and I know a few guys who share this opinion, the major pentatonic, a common misconception is that it's derived from the major scale, but in actual fact, I think it's derived from the Lydian dominant scale, which is the harmonic sequence. Now, again, don't stress if you don't know what that is, it's not the end of the world, we'll actually address that in a future lesson. It's this scale, anyway. Now, this, when I say the harmonic sequence, this basically means if you play the harmonics down an A string, you get a Lydian dominant scale. We're not going to get into that today, right? There is a reason why Lydian dominant is a great sounding scale, because it's the scale of physics. We're not going to get into that, right? That is way off the deep end of today's topic. But Kevin, thank you so much for your question. I really appreciate it. We don't actually have any more questions in the stream. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to curtail that there. We've gone for 40 minutes. This was pretty long. But hopefully that was a reasonable look, at least. Hopefully that was a useful look for you guys at the way that pentatonic scales kind of interact with chords, where they come from, where they go to. Now, in the future, in the next couple of lessons, what we're going to be looking at is we're going to be looking at how you turn your pentatonic scales into modal scales, and not just how, but how you use them and when you use them, when you don't use them. There are probably more don'ts than do's, but that's another subject for another day. Make sure you get yourself into the Guitar Interactive live stream hub, though, because that's the only way you're going to be able to access these lessons. They're only going to be available in the live stream hub. You won't find them anywhere else. So this one is going to be, again, live on our YouTube channel. It's live on the main Guitar Interactive Facebook page, but the next ones are only going to be in the live stream hub. So make sure you join up. It's free to do so. Don't need to do anything. And what we're going to be doing is we're going to be answering all of your questions on the live stream hub. We'll be answering them live. We're also going to be bringing you guys on to the video chat if you want to, so you'll be able to come on camera and ask us questions like live in the stream, so to speak. I'll even give you some homework and things to practice if you like. So there you go, guys. That was a brief introduction to pentatonic scales and modal scales and beyond. Let's see. Oh, Nick Harrison has a question. This is Nick. Everybody knows Nick. Nick is a good friend of mine, great guitar player, pianist, and musical mind. He says, isn't the mixed Lydian mode just a major pentatonic in a party dress? Depends on the party, Nick. I would suggest if it was a ball gown, it's probably probably not. Probably the Lydian mode is the major pentatonic in a ball gown, but in like a spangly dress for going out to the nightclub, then yes, the mixed Lydian mode is just a pentatonic scale in a party dress. So there you go. I've heard him say that before. Never had a clever answer for it. Still don't. Anyway, there you go, guys. In a nutshell, that was a brief lesson. It's a little bit of a look into what you're going to get if you join the live stream hub. So make sure you do so. I am going to leave you there. My name is Nick Jennison. Thank you so much for joining me. I will see you guys this time next week, Thursday, in the live stream hub. Link in the description. I'll see you over there.